Praise God, everybody, and welcome to today's broadcast. We are so delighted that you have joined us. I trust that you're having a great first part of 2017. This is a great year, but today is the day that the Lord has made for you, and you should rejoice. Why? Because God always has a word that will revolutionize your life and actually change the trajectory of how your life is going. Today, we're going to be sharing a message about occupying. God wants us to occupy. The Lord said in the word of God that he gave something to his servants and he wanted them to occupy with that until he returns. When you're occupying, you need to be equipped. And so today in this message, we're going to share some truths from the word of God that will revolutionize your life and help you to live a kingdom overcoming life. It's those that overcome that will occupy. Not those that sit around and talk. You are an overcomer, so start occupying. The more the saints occupy, the less the devil can have his fingers in, and we'll drive the devil and his bunch crazy, which that's what we're supposed to do anyway. Say this, I'm an overcomer. Yes, you are. Let's go into this message. I know it will bless you. Amen. Luke chapter 19 and verse 11. Now, as they heard these things, he spoke another parable, talking about the Lord Jesus, because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants, delivered to them 10 minas, and said to them, do business or occupy till I come. Look at your neighbor and say, you've been equipped, and you're being sent to occupy. Amen. Before you see to tell somebody, it's time for you to occupy. Amen. You can be seated. It's time for you to occupy. The church has got to get this in her hearing that it's time for us to occupy. We began sharing with you recently about this past Wednesday, we talked about the greatest season is here. And the Bible talks about in the Old Testament, even into the New Testament, that there was in the last days, there's a window of time where something marvelous was going to happen. And there would be another outpouring of the Spirit of God. Not what happened at Pentecost, something bigger than that. Pentecost, in the book of Acts, when that happened, the church took off, and it was in its infancy stage, if we can use that term. But here we are in the latter end of the last days, and it's a small window of time. And with that small window of time, everything that God has promised, everything that he has promised you, it's got to be fulfilled in that little window of time. This outpouring includes a restoration. In the book of Acts chapter 2, Peter, you know, when the Holy Spirit came and all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak in tongues, and they thought they were drunk at 9 a.m. He said, no, this is what Joel was talking about. This is the beginning of it. Well, here we are in these last days or this last season, and it's the greatest season because God's going to do what he hasn't done before. There's going to be the greatest harvesting of souls that mankind has ever seen. This is the season that we're in. That's why all hell's been coming at you in ways that you are not familiar with. That's why you're being challenged. It is to get you off course and shift your focus or try to get you to rethink things, to hurt you so that you will blame God for the hurt and back away. Because in this same season, the Bible says that there will be a great falling away or apostasy. Apostasy is like not like somebody walking and they trip and they fell over into something. I ain't playing no more. No, they have tasted the things of God. And because of the climate, they make a conscious decision. I'm walking away from God. I'm done with him. To do that, there is no other place to go but darkness. And so there are people waiting on you to declare the good word of God to them. Amen. And so from this point on, we want the church, every believer everywhere, to be armed with the word of God, walking in the love of God, and living by faith. You can't base your life on what you see because it changes all the time. Life is kind of like TV now. You got 700-800 channels. You can look at something different every few minutes. But if you're like that, you'll never be stable. And that's what the enemy's banking on. That's why he's been messing with your head. Are y'all here? Tell somebody, say, this is the greatest season. And so the greatest season is also the season for us to occupy. Go back to Luke chapter 19. The Lord, in verse 13, he tells this parable, and it says that this particular Lord, this guy, he's a nobleman, he's somebody. He gave something to his servants. The Amplified calls them bond servants. Of course, Paul uses that word to describe himself and all other saints, that when we're in with the Lord, we got to see ourselves as bond servants. You're still a son, a daughter of God, but operating in this earth, we're going to have to walk like he walked, and that was the servant. Isaiah calls it the ideal servant. He wants to reproduce himself in us, where we live and function in life and do the ministry or the business of the kingdom. We do just like he did. We walk in the same anointing that he walked in. Amen. And so his thing is we have to be bond servants. That means you can't get out. You lock yourself in. Totally committed. Any totally committed people in the house? Yeah. Everybody say, now it's time for me to occupy. He gives them money that's equivalent to 100 days' wages. And he tells them, go and do business for me or occupy until I return. We have bought into this thing in the church that being a Christian, you know, I just put my name on the roll and I escape hell. But we don't know how to live up until the time we're ready to leave this earth. God wants us to live, but we live with purpose, and that living means that we occupy. Everybody say occupy. Well, what are we supposed to occupy? Well, give me a second. I'm going to get you there. Go over to Matthew chapter 11. Matthew 11 and find verse 16. This is the Lord talking again, and he says, there's something about this generation that's interesting. Because this conversation is going on in chapter 11. And he says in verse 16, what should I liken this generation, or what should I compare it to? What should I compare this generation to? He says it's like children sitting in the marketplace. Sitting in the marketplaces. Children in the marketplace and calling to their companions and saying, we played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We mourned to you and you didn't even lament. In the marketplace, say in the marketplace. In the marketplace. The word occupy, I want to tie these two together. The word occupy, it means to busy oneself with trade. It means to practice. It means to execute. It's the affairs that you've been assigned. He said, busy yourself with that. Oh. So when you got saved, that was something assigned to you. So what the Lord was saying, occupy till I come. Busy yourself with God's appointed trade or practice and execute it well because it's your kingdom business matter. that you've been assigned. You have a kingdom business matter that's been assigned to you, and God says, I want you to occupy, do business for the kingdom with that in the earth until I come back. But keep this in mind. Everything about the kingdom of God does not sit still. It's always in advancing mode. How many know you have an assignment? Let me see your hand. Okay, keep your hand up. I want the rest of you to look. Now ask the nearest person that's got their hand up. Keep your hand up. I'm trying to put it down, trying to get out of this. Ask whoever's near you. Ask them, what are you doing with it? And they got to answer. Ain't nobody answering. Okay, I'll keep going. See, we have bought into this thing. If you go to church and you jump and shout and you do a couple of shana nas and you let them see you when you come to church, I'm here, Rev. I'm here. Yeah. And just got your name on the roll and not knowing that you have an assignment. Well, there are those that think because I got an assignment, now I just go do my assignment. They're independent. No, that's a rogue. Every assignment dovetails into a bigger assignment. God connects you to a church. You don't just go say, I'm going over here. No, you got to find out, where am I assigned? Because the word to activate the assignment in your belly is in the place that God assigns you. If you're not there, you can hear the word, because it ain't but one word. But it'll never activate what's in you. You ever had an itch and you just needed it scratched? And you're like, my back itching. And your spouse, your husband, you know, they say, you might even get the kid. Come scratch my back. And they scratching, but they didn't get the itch. You know, when they get the itch, you go, it's something about the itch when you touch it. When the word of God activates the itch of your assignment, something comes online in you. So we got a lot of saints just walking around living itching. You got an itch, but you can't get it scratched. Amen. So after you're born again, we are saved to do work. Your assignment. Y'all didn't know that? It went cold when I said do work. Because in the church, I just want the Lord to bless me. He already has. Well, I mean, I don't see nothing. We need to get the whole picture. The blessing has been given. It's your inheritance. What keeps it from being activated in your life or keep you from accessing what God has given to you? It's disobedience to his word. We think God's mad at us. He trying. No, if he was mad, he wouldn't have saved you. God ain't mad. Amen. So when we get born again, we're supposed to do this good work that the Father has ordained for us to do. Remember, well, let me read it to you. Ephesians chapter 2. You don't have to turn there, but Ephesians 2, it says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So your purpose is a good work. Your assignment is a good work. A good work is a God work. And when you do it, God will say, now that's good. That's just like me. That's what he said in Genesis. After God did different things, he looked at it and says, that's good. That's me. That's what I ordered. That's when you hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. And he doesn't just say that. There's increase that comes behind that. Because in this story, those that he told to occupy, they had to come give an account. The one that had five given to him, he came and gave an account. He said, well done. You did it. That's what I wanted. He says, come and I will make you ruler. Wait a minute. He was given wages that's equivalent to 100 days salary. And he increased it. And that nobleman said, well done, good and faithful servant, come, and I will make you ruler over 10 cities. So the way he handled things put him in a position to be a ruler. Yeah, he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Okay, who are the lords and who are the kings that he's king over and lord over? It's you. But you won't be able to stand in that unless you are faithful to occupy. Is this too much? You want to hear about Daniel and the lion den? Noah and the ark. But watch this. I want to tie these together because we're supposed to be occupying, but the Lord said, there's a problem here because I equate this generation to children playing in the marketplaces. So we need to identify what are the marketplaces, because the children are playing in the marketplaces. Playing. If you don't know what the marketplace is, you won't know the purpose of the marketplace. Okay? Well, let me do that. The marketplaces, and we've talked about this, but we're coming at it from a different angle. The marketplaces are the spheres of influence in society. They're called worlds or mountains of influence. Wherever you go, you will find these. And here they are. Business, commerce. You got education, arts and entertainment, media, family, religion or church. And you got government. So the church is supposed to be occupying the marketplaces. The Lord said what the church is doing, what the children are doing, is playing in the marketplaces. Playing is not occupying, because the marketplace is where you do business. That's where power is transferred. The church is supposed to be occupying the places of power and influence, but the church has been playing like children. Remember the Lord, when he asked the disciples, he said, now, who do men say that I am? Well, they've been involved with the talk. You know, they go in the grocery store and they see the tabloids, you know, the gossip columns, and they on the phone. Y'all ain't got no creativity this morning. Who do they say I am? And somebody said, well, you know, somebody say you John the Baptist. Somebody else said, they told me you Elijah. You one of the old prophets that's dead. You done come back to life. That's who you is. And then he said, who do you? Because you've been involved in the conversation. Who do you say I am? You with me all the time. And nobody said anything but Peter. Peter said, you are the Christ. You are the king that was prophesied to come and redeem mankind. God manifested in the flesh. That's you. You are the Christ. And he said, Pete, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. But my Father who is in heaven, he opened the eyes of your understanding. Peel back that that's been hiding who I am and let you see me. Go over to Matthew 11. You might as well read it. Matthew 11, because this is very interesting here with occupying the marketplaces. Matthew, what did I tell you, 11? This is where the Lord, I think I'm in the wrong one. It's where he told Peter that flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. I think I got the wrong one. He said, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. But my Father, which is in heaven. I got the wrong one. Flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. My Father revealed it to you. Then he says, upon this rock, I will build my church. What happened afterwards? And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. We've always thought that the gates of hell is coming against the church. No, it's the other way around. Because you know what's on the other side of the gates? Everything that belonged to you. Why would hell try to put up a fight if there was nothing to get? On the other side of the gates are the marketplaces. Held by Satan and his bunch. And did you know the marketplaces? It's where everybody's everyday life occurs. See, we come from where we come from and come to this place that we call the church. This ain't the church. It's just a building that we meet in. You don't disrespect it. But you are. And let me take it a little bit further. Did you know Caesar and Pilate, they had a church? They're called out ones. That's what the church means. We are the body of Christ, the anointed one. We're the called out ones out of the world into the kingdom of God. And we have this assignment now to go back and occupy, because the kingdom of God is in advancing mode. So we're supposed to be assaulting the gates. And the Lord said, and they won't be able to withstand you. But what should I liken this generation to? They ain't been occupying or assaulting the gates and going behind the gates of hell, snatching the gates off their hinges and occupying the territory. Did you know if you occupy the territory, the marketplaces that's behind the gate, that means the walls and the gates of hell move back. And that that's being occupied is now under kingdom of God occupation. Am I making sense? And so we bought into this thing. Oh, just praise him. Oh, praise him. Do it a little bit more. And we sweat. Oh, you got it. Squall. And somebody's supposed to run up and fan me. No, I'm not making fun of that. The point I'm trying to get to is that when we don't understand the marketplaces and what we're supposed to be occupying, we will be like children sitting in the marketplaces playing. And the playing involves this. We spend our time and our energy manipulating each other. What's in the manipulation? Oh, they tell me they got 10,000 members. God didn't call me to preach. I go become a member of that 10,000 member church with the intent to draw at least 400 to me. And they follow me because I have charisma. I'm anointed. See, they pray all day. When I pray, the power of God hit them and they fall. They ain't never the same. I'm anointed. They old, I'm young. It's my time. I'm going to start my own church. And I'm leaving, and the 400 follow you. 400 to start a church? You're doing real good. What influence? But you got it through the means that witches get theirs. You went into a house and played Jezebel's harlot and created a sore in the house of God, damaging his people. Well, praise God. I trust that you were blessed by that message. I know you should be, because you're watching, and that tells me that your heart is open to the word of God, for the Spirit of God to deposit what you need deposited. You have been created by God, all of us, to be a success story. So let's be a success story and occupy the territory that God has called us to occupy. Before we leave today, let me pray for you. Father, I thank you in the name of the Lord Jesus that by the power of the Holy Spirit, everyone listening to this broadcast, that they will be equipped by you with the word of God to occupy what you call them to occupy, and that their life will unleash all the potential that you placed on the inside of them that will bring glory to your name. Make them overcomers, because it's the overcomers that sit down with you. We thank you that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. We give you praise and thanks for every person, every household, every believer, every city around the globe. Thank you for the marvelous occupation that's taking place in the body of Christ. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now listen, we want you to stay tuned for more of today's this broadcast as we cover these points about occupying. This word will bring your life to a place where everything gels so that God can be glorified. Join us again for more of the Heart of the Ideal Servant.
Thank you for joining us for the Heart of a Servant, an outreach ministry of Canaan Christian Center in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. If you are in the Pine Bluff area, we'd love for you to join us on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. for our United Prayer on Tuesdays at 6 p.m. and for our midweek service on Wednesday night at 7. We would also like to give a special thank you to all of our covenant partners. If you are interested in becoming a covenant partner, please visit our website or send us an email. We are Canaan Christian Center, praying that you have the heart of the ideal servant.